agree with it. But I'm the one doing the fighting. You're the one that has to live with it. Okay? So in terms of guns, I get carried away, I'm sorry. So in terms of guns, you're able to have a firearm in your vehicle and go from home to work and back home. You can have a firearm in your vehicle going from home to the gun store and back home. Now, my advice to gun owners in this audience is you want to keep it secure and out of sight. If you drive around, because we are in Texas and people love to show their rifles. It is the way it is. Keep that gun out and in plain sight, that's what they call it, in plain sight. If that cop pulls you over, it gives them reasonable suspicion and almost probable cause to search your vehicle. Okay, it's in plain sight. It's a very great topic. 9 times out of 10, they're gonna mess with you about that gun. They are. It's gonna happen. But that's when you be quiet, ask for your attorney, and hire us. Let us do the fighting for you. I am a licensed holder. I can walk around with a gun right here throughout San Antonio streets. But I'm not gonna do it. That's my choice. Because keep in mind, if you do, they're gonna be watching. They're going to be watching. So you can't go smoke weed. You can't go speeding. You can't drink and drive because of that situation. They're watching you. So that's why I'm saying you have the right, but it comes with consequences. And you have to be aware of those consequences. When I went through this class, and this is very important, because I heard this tons of times after the Trayvon Martin issue had occurred. Everybody wants to carry a gun and shoot somebody. It's getting out of control. While I'm sitting in this class, I don't tell anybody I'm returning. I just sit there and listen like everybody else. I'm not trying to one-up anybody. I want to know as much as I can. Out of a class of 11, six people, more than 50% were asking scenarios. So what if I see a guy beat up his girlfriend? Can I shoot the guy? Or what if I see a guy beating up on the police? Can I go shoot the guy? Or what if I see a guy running from the store? Can I shoot the guy? And they wouldn't give advice. So I want to clear this up right now. If you pull the trigger on any individual, you are going to be arrested. You are going to jail. You are going to bond out, and you're going to have to fight this case. But Cruz, we have the right to self-defense. You do have the right to self-defense. But self-defense is what's called an affirmative defense, which means, okay, you can do it, but you have to justify it. And the only people, which is not followed very often here in Bexar County, the only people that can claim that justified is a jury or a DA's office. Not police officers. They cannot say that was a justified killing. That is not their role. It's to go to the DA and to a jury trial. But you're still going to go through the entire motion. Keep that in mind. I know we love our guns. We want to protect ourselves. But my question to you is this. Is it worth it? You pull that gun out and someone will kill you and claim self-defense. So we have to be very strategic, we have to think about these things before we want to jump to assert our rights to do certain things. I want to see everybody in this room live a long and prosperous life. I'm tired of going to funerals. I go to funerals all the time, from clients, from people in our community. Mm-hmm. I'm tired of it. And I speak to young people all the time because, you know, I know I'm going too long, I'm sorry. You know, we don't want to listen to authority, we want to do certain things. But at the end of the day, is your life worth it? You have to think about these things. Like I said, it's a no having a gun. Keep it tucked away to protect yourself in case something happens. But if you're quick to pull out that gun and start shooting, be known, or let it be known, that you're going to get arrested. You are going to jail. They're going to prosecute you, and you're going to have to hire an attorney to fight for your rights. And that's going to be, depending on who you hire, hundreds of thousands of dollars that you do not get back. Okay. I don't know if this is a time to question and answer, or...
We have enough.
Okay. With that, I'll be here for a little bit for the panel discussion. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome to the...
Yes.
Come on, baby.
For the sake of time, I think it's, what, 1:35 right now? Okay, please make sure I don't go over 5 minutes, okay? Because we do have another speaker coming up, and we want to give you a chance to ask some questions and obviously get business cards from the different attorneys that are here so you can get actual legal advice. This is just a seminar. Nothing here is actual legal advice, and we have not created an attorney-client relationship. We need to get that out there. Okay. I'm here today to, I'm Natasha Sherrod. I'm a practicing attorney. I just moved down the street on East Houston Street back in August, so I'm very close by. My focus area, even though I do practice criminal law as well, and I do wills and estates, my focus though, my passion is family law. And the reason that I'm here today to talk about family law in conjunction with these rights here is because there are areas of family law that have criminal consequences. And most of you are aware with individuals that have baby mama drama or daddy, you know, baby daddy drama, and people say, oh, that person's bipolar and they're always having problems in their relationships, and they may be charged with assault, bodily injury. Well, on my end, I will represent the individual who's seeking a protective order. Now, the thing is, though, is that on occasion, I'll get individuals that come to me because they have a protective order, and they're like, but mom is still talking to me, or the dad is the one that's coming to me and it's like, well, you know, everything's okay. You know, we've made up, and, you know, she says I can come over and stuff, but I have this protective order. What are my rights? Can I still, is it okay because she gave me permission? The truth is, it's not okay. The person that's protected by a protective order can never say that it's now okay for the other person to violate that protective order. If individuals have a protective order against them and they're stopped by the police, or let's say the tradition, the most common sense is the police are called to the residence because they've gotten into an argument again. If you have a protective order, there is nothing that you can say to justify why you're there. If that protective order says you are to have no contact with that individual, you're not to be within so many yards of their residence, there is no justification you can state to say, well, it's okay for me to be there. So that's an instance where it's best to remain silent. You're going to get arrested. However, your attorney may be able to mitigate the charges against you. The best thing to do, however, is to seek legal counsel before you encounter the police, because if you have a protective order, the standard length of time is 2 years. But if within that year, let's say it's looking like, you know, you think you guys are gonna make up, because let's be truthful about it, in relationships, you have a protective order. We know those that represent survivors of domestic violence, oftentimes the survivors go back. They go back to that individual for whatever reason, and we're not here to judge that. What I'm here to tell you is that for 1 year, you cannot request a modification to be done. If there's a protective order against you and you feel like, look, it's time, me and my significant other, my wife, we want to get back together, you have children, get an attorney first. You need to have an attorney who will go into court and request if that protective order can be shortened to just a 1 year time frame. Because if not, that protective order states you are not to have any communication with that individual for 2 years. The other thing I wanted to state about protective orders is that it's a two-part process. The individual is going to apply for a protective order, and 9 times out of 10, they request what's called an ex parte protective order. That means that based on the victim's statement alone, they are requesting the judge to grant that protective order. It's a temporary protective order, and then we're going to have you brought into court to actually do the final 2-year one. It's important that you have an attorney that will defend that protective order to make sure that you don't have one that states that you committed acts of family violence if you have not. Because again, you will be in jail for violating the protective order, and there's really not much that you can say to defend that. The other thing, I know my 5 minutes is up, one more little quick little thing, is if there's a custody order, it's very important that you follow that custody order, because in your visitation orders, a lot of times it states you're only to have the children on the weekends, first, third, fifth weekends, but mom says, no, it's okay, you can have them during the week because he's a teenager now and he's driving me crazy. You need to get that modified, because there is a state jail felony which will put you in jail for 2 years, up to 2 years, and up to a $10,000 fine for violating or interfering with child custody. And so those are just two areas where, again, family law has some criminal ramifications to it. For further information, I do have a business card to give you at the end of our presentation today.
Do you mind if I introduce the next speaker?
All right, we're having to change up the agenda just a little bit. I believe that we wanted to have a few words, just very briefly, on civil liberties, and that will be from Attorney Tess House. And then following her, we will have a presentation by Linda Corley and Roland Eichmann of DWI Stocks. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Attorney Artessa House. I'm pleased to come to you today. I'm a San Antonio native, so issues that touch and concern the city of San Antonio are close to my heart because I grew up here, generally Converse, Texas, but mostly San Antonio. And I'm also educated here because I'm a graduate of St. Mary's Law School. So I stand before you as a lawyer, fresh out of law school 2 years, but it's been an exciting 2 years. Right after I was licensed, there was a protest at North Star Mall, and this protest was organized by local young leaders of the community in order to commemorate the deaths of unarmed men. And I went out there fresh out of law school because I really believed in what these individuals were standing up for. North Star Mall really honored the civil liberties of our citizens and allow these protesters to stage a die-in in the middle of the mall. And so we commend North Star Mall for safeguarding the civil rights and free speech of our individuals. However, after the die-in ceased, the protesters took the protest outside of the mall. And therein lies where problems occurred. The protesters decided to, at some point, take the protests on the street and into the highway, where oncoming traffic was occurring. Obviously, to law enforcement, this posed a safety risk because there was oncoming traffic, and then you have pedestrians in the roadway. At that point, two arrests occurred, and those gentlemen left with Class C misdemeanor charges. There were no lawyers on the floor except me, and I was freaked out because I didn't know what I was doing. I sent a call to my fellow colleagues, and it was on a Saturday. You know, a lot of attorneys don't work on a Saturday. When you're a young attorney like me, you don't have a choice but to work on a Saturday. So I was there, and I was able to assist those protesters in getting out, negotiated an agreement as far as what their charges were, and so they're free today, and they continue to protest on the streets of San Antonio. However, based on that first incident, and our education on what we can and cannot do when it comes to civil liberties and how that clashes with the law, they were able to refine their approach as to what they do on the streets of San Antonio. So what does this mean? And I will say, and I'm just going to talk about the city of San Antonio because every protest is different. How many of you all have Facebook, right? Raise your hand if you have Facebook. So you see on social media, how many of you have seen protesters blocking the highway? Raise your hand if you've seen those. Yes. So some cities, it happens. Don't do that in San Antonio, though. You may be arrested, okay? So I will say, depending on your approach when it comes to protesting, I think it is very specific to the actual city that you are in. San Antonio, however, I will say, the city has evolved over the years. They have been very supportive and per se respectful, and I say per se because it depends on what you call respectful. There have been some occurrences where protesters have gathered and they are there with video cameras taping. They are recording. This is law enforcement officers. They are taping. It's every single move of what the protesters are doing. When I say protesters, I'm talking well above Black Lives Matter. I'm talking about actual citizens just coming together that are concerned about the death of unarmed men in the streets of San Antonio. Right now, I've been consoling a mother who is my client. Her son was shot last year while an officer was trying to, I guess, apprehend him, take him into custody. So her son was driving his white Mercedes. They pulled into their apartment complex where they lived. As soon as they entered into a parking spot, her son exited the car. An officer who had been following him pulled out his gun, told him to put your hands up and turn around. Apparently, he complied very quickly. The officer shot and killed this young man. And he killed him to the point where, when he was shot, his shoes were in one location and his body was in another. Then we hear, all of a sudden in the news story, I see a next news story, and I'm watching it because I'm looking at the Facebook news feed. So the news is reporting it. Then all of a sudden, a cell phone appears. And the officer said he had a cell phone in his hand. But that wasn't reported in the beginning. And so it's interesting how these stories evolve. But what I will say, back to civil liberties, here's what I will say. It's very important, and I'm just going to give you, like, realistic approaches as to how you can protect your civil liberty. I'm a big social media person. I think it's good when you know how to use it to your benefit. Become familiar with a lot of the tools that you have been equipped with. Facebook Live. Who's familiar with Facebook Live? I'm trying to become a little bit more comfortable with it. Facebook Live. We'll start recording these instances. Texas happens to be a one-party consent state, right? As long as you are present and you are a party to the conversation or communication or what's going on, you can record to the point that it does not interfere with any type of law enforcement investigation. Facebook Live and the information that us as attorneys are able to use from the different feedbacks that come from Facebook video recordings or Snapchat or Instagram, you never know how integral that is. Mr. Calvert mentioned, Commissioner Calvert, excuse me, mentioned earlier about the Whataburger arrest. Raise your hand if you heard about the Whataburger arrest, right? So there were two African-American young ladies. They had went to an after party, the after gathering at Whataburger after a game at Judson High School. They go, and one girl's driving and the other girl is a passenger in the car. The passenger in the car goes and she buys food. So she is a customer of Whataburger. Are we clear? Y'all following the story? As she's ordering the food, she's waiting for the food, all of a sudden a fight breaks out between two young men outside. So what do kids do, right? Some kids, they rush outside to see the fight, right? Some stay in because they're waiting for their food. Well, Whataburger does what? They call who?
Police.
They call the police. Yeah. Police arrive, right? Police arrive on the scene to investigate what happens. All of a sudden, police says, everyone get the F out, right? Excuse my French, but that's what was said to all customers and patrons because I want to paint a visual of exactly what went on here. So, customers are still waiting for food. The drive-thru is actively going on. It's an operating restaurant. Goes one by one and starts to clear out the restaurant. Apparently, one of the girls didn't move fast enough. Do you see a common theme?
Yeah, sure.
It's not that they were complying. Maybe they were, it's a matter of perspective at this point. Didn't move fast enough. Girl gets arrested, and then her friend gets arrested as well because the officer, during the transaction, takes her hat off, throws it across the restaurant. She tells her friend, pick up my hat and put it on my head. her friend complies because this girl is the daughter of a very well-known hairstylist here in San Antonio, so she cares about her looks, right? Puts her hat on her head, and the girl gets arrested for interfering with that arrest. And as Mr. Calver said, he's absolutely right. Now, there are a lot of people that would take credit for having those charges dropped. I will say, I am the attorney for those girls, their criminal attorney and their federal civil rights attorney. When I sat down with Nico LaHood, he mentioned Mr. Calvert's name and said, Tommy called me and said, we're getting pressure from the community. So even though you say, what can I do? I don't have a law degree. I didn't always have a law degree. I was a teacher at Martin Luther King, teaching sixth grade. I didn't have a law degree, but I saw injustices. So what do? Call Nico LaHood's office. If you see that an officer needs to be prosecuted for wrongdoing, call him. If you think that he doesn't listen, he listens, because he went down the list and told me every single person that called on behalf of those girls. It was the pressure from the community that caused those charges to be dropped. So if you think it doesn't matter, it does. And so from an attorney to the community, I just want to thank you, because you're my community. This is where I grew up. So it matters to me that you all backed up the community, and County Commissioner Tommy Calvert, you backed these girls. The charges were dropped. Sheriff Parmalee had no clue, because I talked to her and she was talking as if these girls were going to be prosecuted to the full extent of the law. I mean, there was no crime. He was a paying customer. And I said, at the end of the day, the boys that were fighting got away scot-free, because they made no other arrest that night other than that paying customer and the girl that drove her there. So when we talk about civil liberties, what it takes is community participation. If you see something's wrong, if you think your constitutional rights are violated, you don't have to remember the Constitution. You know, some people say, you violated my constitutional rights. Oh, which right? Sometimes you can't say it, but you know something wrong happened. So take it to the house. Call Tess House. Call your attorney and say, hey, Tess House, I feel my rights are violated.
Tell you how those rights were violated. Okay, thank you. Okay, now we're going to have Linda Horley and Linda Hackman come up. And let's see, we have about 10 minutes before I think. Well, just quickly, my wife and I were laid down in the street in front of River Center Mall. We did a die-in there. I also died in with the young people in North Carolina. They had helped me get back up. And I died in. By the way, it's good for older people to support our younger people. We don't do that enough. And instead of complaining about them when you're doing the right thing, we need to be there with them.
I'm sorry for interrupting. I am running for District 8, and one of the things I wanted to tell you is that your city council is also very, very responsive. You've got some very good people up there who are ready to take your phone calls, and so just any city council person will take that phone call and take it very seriously. The other thing, I give similar talks, I'm an attorney as well, I give similar talks to college students around Texas. One of the things I always make them do, Tess, and you may want to tell your clients, is who's got a phone?
Everybody
got a phone? Right. Mm-hmm. Who can download an app?
Yes.
Everybody. There's an app out there called Mobile Justice by the ACLU, Ed, where it actually lets you video, and a cop cannot take your phone away and erase it. Because we've all heard of that too, right? Where you take your phone and erase it. This live streams it directly to the ACLU, and all you got to do is call the ACLU afterwards and say, can I get my video? And the only problem is Texas ACLU hasn't developed theirs, and so Oklahoma, Washington, D.C., and Georgia have one, but I recommend it. You can always call the ACLU in Georgia.
Thank you.
Sorry for interrupting.
That's right. Thank you very much. Good. Give him a hand. Before we start, we've got about 5 minutes. I'm going to ask Pastor to let us go like 5 minutes more past 2 o'clock. He's in command. We may run a little bit over, but I hope that's okay. But make it quick, because we would like to get out of here on time.
Okay. My name is Roland Ackman. I'm a licensed attorney in Texas. This is Linda Corley. She's a licensed attorney in Texas. She runs the office. She's the head of their law firm. We're going to show you a 2-minute video that sort of recaps the 20-minute video that you saw at the beginning of the presentation today. It's a little simpler. What we've found is that in stressful situations, maybe two or three rules. So you have to act on what the cop can do as opposed to what you think he might do.
You don't have to quote amendments. You don't have to quote all of these things. You just have to know, we all generally know what our rights are. What we haven't been able to do is to translate that into our own lives. When the situation is occurring, how do we make that happen? How do we really invoke our rights? And so we're trying to make it simple. You can adjust this for different kinds of stops. We're doing a DWI stop as an example, but you can really use this for any kind of an encounter with a police officer.
No encounter with a police officer ever makes you any money. Nothing good comes out of an encounter with a police officer.
Let's play a video.
Wait a minute, just a moment. There's been, I can't remember his name. Sorry, what's your name?
William Shaw.
William Shaw. He's right about he made a comment about you make decisions and there's consequences to them. But you cannot know what a cop is going to do. All you can know is what they can do. If you consent to a cop searching your vehicle, in Texas, the law for possession of marijuana is any usable amount. I could have five usable amounts underneath my fingernails and it could pop into the carpet of your car, and it reaches in and pulls that out, and that's a Class B misdemeanor. I've seen it charged. They do it all the time. I personally will never consent to a search in my car, and I won't let a cop in my house unless they've got a search warrant or an arrest warrant. I won't even open the door for them. You don't have a duty to open the door to a cop without a warrant. Now this, what you're gonna see is a DWI stop, but all the rules that are shown in this video work for an encounter, any kind of encounter, in your house, anywhere. You just take the DWI questions out of it, and I follow these rules religiously. Insurance, please. Do you have anything illegal in your car?
No, I'll answer any questions.
Will you be smart with me?
I'll answer questions.
Do you have any drugs in your vehicle?
Sorry, I'll ask questions.
Why don't you answer my questions?
I'll ask questions.
Contents of your wallet?
No, I don't consent to service.
I need you to do some field sobriety tests so I can be sure it's safe when you drive home.
Sorry, I don't do field sobriety tests either. You're there, right there.
Who told you that?
I'll answer questions.
If you don't do the field sobriety test, I'll have to arrest you and get out of the car.
I'm sorry, I don't do field sobriety tests.
You're under arrest. When we get down to the jail, you'll have an opportunity to blow up the machine and prove you're not intoxicated.
I don't blow either. I'm sorry, it's not reliable.
Who told you that?
Sorry, I'll answer questions.
I've had enough of your attitude. I'm going to enjoy watching you get strapped out of the chair for a blood draw.
I don't consent to blood draws either.
You're going to draw your blood anyway. What do you think of that?
I don't answer any questions.
Two will just show you how to handle an end of the line stop and any other disease encounter. Don't answer questions and do not consent to any search. When dealing with the cops, being tough won't keep you out of trouble. Being smart does. Maybe you're in the counter with the cops just like Two Real did. Then, if you get charged, call me, Linda Corley. I do just what Two Real does in the ring, only in the courtroom. I keep it real and I will fight with you. Understand it's not always to do that. It's very intimidating when you're talking to an officer, but we want to give you the strength to know that you have the right
to invoke your rights. And how do you do that? You do that by telling them, I'm sorry, I'm not going to answer any questions, okay? You can cooperate with a police officer, but that doesn't mean you have to answer every question and do every little thing that he wants, okay? So you have a right. They love to say, no refusal weekend. Well, what a joke. What are they going to do if you take these sobriety tests that are designed to cause you to lose your balance, and then they're going to say you're intoxicated because of that? You're going to end up under arrest, right? What's going to happen if you say, no, I'm not going to take those tests? You're going to end up under arrest. What we're trying to make you understand is you will live through the experience. It's traumatic. But what I hope that everybody will do is when we get stopped by a police officer, it is our, we want to go home, right?
Right.
You want to go home. So you want to answer whatever questions you can. You want to be cooperative and tell them everything you can because you want to go home. You want to do everything that they want to say because you think if you do what they say, they'll let you go home. They're not going to let you go home. If they bounced you out of your room, well, 9 times out of 10, you're going to jail. So what I hope that everybody will have the strength to do is instead of making decisions for that short-term thing to try to go home tonight, make long-term decisions. If you're planning for your long-term defense, what you do is going to be different than if you're trying to talk a police officer to let you go home that you and I both know you're never going to talk into. Because what do they get paid to do? Arrest people. How do they get judged about whether they're doing their job, right? You didn't make any arrests. What are you out there doing, right? So make your decisions not based on the moment of trying to achieve a result that you're probably not going to get. They've already decided if they're going to arrest you. Doesn't matter what you say or do, you're going. Make your decisions and behave in such a way that your longer defense is you beat this rap because you're not guilty or whatever. And that's another thing I want to talk about. Everybody talks about, well, guilty people exercise their rights. You don't have anything to hide. You don't lie to search. No, your rights are not tied to guilt or innocence. They have nothing to do with whether you are guilty or innocent. They are your constitutional rights. Our citizens have fought and served and died so you have these rights. And so I hope that we can teach everybody how to make it happen in their own personal life that you exercise these rights. It will stop certain things from happening. The one thing I do want to clarify on the video is it talked about the best way to exercise your right to remain silent is to remain silent. And that makes such common sense, doesn't it? But as you and I know, the people that make all the rules, right, up to the Supreme Court, they're a little disconnected from reality sometimes. Wouldn't you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
They had come down with a ruling that says, well, you have not invoked your right to remain silent if you just remain silent. In order to actually invoke your rights and the protections that it will provide you, you actually have to speak. You have to say, I want to remain silent. So I encourage you, always, the two things you need to say to the police officer, I want an attorney, and I want to remain silent. And then please do remain silent, please. If you start talking to the police officer again, you have waived your right, okay? So don't answer questions. Tell them, I want an attorney. Everybody say that, I want an attorney. Don't say, I want my attorney. You're not Tony Soprano. You don't have a right? I want an attorney.
I want an attorney.
I'm remaining silent. And then do it. Now your rights, these rights don't attach to you until you're under custodial arrest. I don't want you guys to try to figure out when you're under custodial arrest. It's a little legal twist we do. Okay, don't try to figure that out. Know your rights, and I don't care that you don't have the right to invoke them yet, you just keep invoking them. Okay, you do it because it's your right. And stand strong and don't be afraid because you can call us. You can call Therese, you can call Natasha, you can call me, you can call Mr. Shaw. And we will help you in court and we will fight for you. I'm here today because I believe that we all need to stand up for our rights. Until we do, we will not be able to stop this overrun and overreach of government and police and everyone. And so please don't hesitate to call us if you have questions, okay? I think the last There was one other thing that I was concerned about.
Turn your shit.
The fact is my brain, but look, what I want you to come around with are those two things. Don't answer their questions. It's not going to get you out of trouble. And you don't know what you might say that will cause trouble. What they'll switch. Oh, the last thing, everybody's talked about video. Video is your friend. Pray there's a video. If you see something happening, videotape it, okay? Please, because that's going to be our saving grace, because we can prove what really happened, not just what somebody decides to put in the police report that is so much BS. Okay, we can have an actual video. So, pretend there's a video on you at all times. Hope there's a body cam. Hope there's a dash camera. The police know it's there. They behave in certain ways. Don't play their game. You'll never win it, just like they said on the video. You're not going to win their game on the street. You play your game. You behave like you want a jury to see you, not where the cop wants them to see you, okay? And you're going to win in the end.
All right. All right. Thank you. Let's do this, because we've rapidly run out of time. Let me tell you what I'm going to do. If I ever get in trouble again, I'm going to call all the lawyers that were here and form a great big legal team. Because it sounds like we'll win that case. So let me do this. We wanted to do some question and answer stuff. We can still do that. But why don't we do that like on an individual basis, that the lawyers will hang around? Anyone has individual questions, let's do it that way.